So what we are driving at here is just to get a sense of the complexity of the answers to this question in the room. And I think people in the room are perhaps best equipped to do this. So keep brainstorming for another minute and then we'll build the picture together. Do you feel like you have a good list going? Still working on it. Yeah,
2 points.
Okay.
2 points, that's good. That's getting it.
The big question.
It is a big question. We just want a sense of how messy it is on the table, right? How complicated it is. That tech is not an agent.
So like if I'm meeting, what if I'm meeting any hands?
Okay, let's start hearing about a couple ways, or more than a couple. Again, you can shout these out and I'll repeat them to the audience.
Diversity and inclusion initiatives.
Okay, diverse, so tech by having diversity and inclusion.
Sure,
yeah. It's a place.
That's one way.
Yes, yes. Okay, great.
The way that algorithms operate is it pushes you into a confirmation bias of it's going to push you to the most polarizing extreme of word decision.
Yes. So algorithms are an agent, a participant in this, pushing toward polarization, extending viewing time by looking for extreme content, those kinds of things. Great. What else?
Yeah. Mine is kind of a little bit more abstract, but I think this idea that we were talking about individualism breeding sort of like loneliness and how this is really sort of at the like heart of tech as being like this rugged individualism, which is at odds with DEI, which necessitates that we like think about the communal good. And so there's just this sort of divide there.
Yeah, remember we, Catherine, a long time ago, worked on the lone wolf programmer image and the origin of a particular kind of individualism within tech. Yes, and it is at some odds with DEI discourse for sure, right? The collective, yes. Okay, folks are hearing that. What else?
And we've got one in the chat.
Okay, great. Let's hear you.
A lot of the ones that I came up with were thinking about like what tech enables or facilitates.
Yes.
In part because of what that they make money off of it, off of the outrage. But I was also thinking about content moderation or lack thereof. Like
yes.
They're kind of disincentivized to moderate that content. But I was also thinking about now that anybody can buy a blue check mark, like, and that I think in our current setting conveys a sense of legitimacy. So how are we legitimizing certain accounts just so they pay $15 a month?
Yes.
To do it. But I also think about the community forums that are created in both good and bad ways. Like you could be a Moms for Liberty group, which is like kind of open to rights, or you could be a Mother for Good group, and you can kind of have those different networks, but I also think about like security issues and doxing threats. Like, what are the ways in which we refuse to take things down when it is very clearly targeting people or might disincentivize people to kind of take on a more public activist role because there are not protections in place for that personal information to be secured?
Yes. So a whole set of issues with those on Zoom around both content moderation and security mechanisms. Is that, that's, I'm grossly overdue, but I'm just trying to
get the chat. They say allowing anonymous identity to promote more candid expression of thoughts.
Yes.
Positive negative thoughts.
Yes, to affirm that Zoom comment, we were discussing that with social dynamics earlier about how people feel more free to like let it out, you know, control it, et cetera, online. Okay, other ways, just brainstorming. Yes,
So one was how they perpetuate bias in hiring, coding, and treatment of people within sort of the girl culture.
Oh, yeah.
The chilly climate stuff, everything that still exists.
Yes.
The way that they may or may not have policies about code of ethics and how they enforce that and how people treat them.
Yes, so all kinds of workplace policies, practices, hiring practices, also informal culture, programmer culture that you're speaking to. Absolutely. Great.
I was going to say tech industry in and of itself is like $1 billion industry. They have the ability to influence one way or the other, like legislation or
what
people want to do, and like just using their size.
Yes. The sheer size, monetary kind of levers, but then also, you know, we were suggesting earlier, they also stand to profit from the rising antagonism and polarization of certain kinds of organizations too, right? Would we also say that tech is itself, because it's spoken of as an agent like that, big tech, become an actual figure, object of the culture wars as well. So it's like deeply embroiled in it. Any other ways that we didn't get?
I draw it down that a lot of our learning data for self-driving cars, for facial recognition, for AI is based on white Caucasian men. Creates problems for women, but primarily for color.
Yes.
Have been hit by cars because they don't get recognized as people.
Yes. And then there's that story is paralleled around all different kinds, right? So it's not just the who's designing, but it's also the data, which is based and a host of other things. So information is biased in the sense as well, right? Yeah. I mean, what is really useful about just this thin kind of swipe that we're taking off the top is that we have revealed a number of agents that are participating in this that are human and non-human, right? Like we have machine agents, capitalist agents, right? Firms, employees, everybody with a stake in it and intentions that are somewhat different. Everybody sort of pulling the lever that they can. Our task in here is to figure out what levers of influence we have. Coming from our very different stakes, I know that's true on Zoom as well, in the tech world, to figure out what levers of influence are within our reach. But I just want to make the point that there is no, there's no utility, there's no point in trying to make any sort of argument, that's not what I'm going to do, about like tech did it or blame the internet or as if it's one thing, right? Obviously, there's so much to be said here, and there's 1,000 participants who are both under the influence of the culture wars, even as they exercise in them, right? So it's incredibly complicated, and we're not looking for a mysterious bad villain behind the curtain. We're trying to understand how has tech played a role in getting us to this particular place in the culture wars, and what does that mean for DEI work? So I've summarized that here as saying the cause of all this is complicated, and it's important for us to remember that. And so we need to create an account that is up to that complication, that is up to that complexity. And so I want you to put a pin in that question, what are your levers of influence? Because that is what we're going to be returning to as the series unfolds. But right now, it's story time. Anybody feeling it? It's the afternoon. Story chat. Settle in for what I'm going to describe as the story of a field. So what I'm going to do here is try to provide a more complex answer to that prior question I asked, how does tech participate that accounts for the very different kinds of influences you raised and more. And the way I'm going to do this is by telling the story not of a particular agent or a person, but the story of a feeling. Okay, that sounds a little bit weird. It's a very human feeling. It's a particularly potent and combustible feeling. You might say that it's not really an emotion. It's more like a sensation, or like that, you know, these feelings you have that are like gnawing and recurring and like a physical urgency, like a conviction. This must be this way. A felt truth, we could say. There's a lot of talk about the post-truth era. I'm going to describe this as a story of, instead of what we usually do, heteronormative, boy meets girl. This is feeling meets network, sensation meets network. And the first part of this story, we're going to tell it in three, and we're just going to do the first part today. And that is, what is this feeling we're talking about, and how did it catch fire? Well, what happens when you take a combustible feeling and you have it encounter a technical web that both has intimate and global capacities? It spreads like wildfire. And that's what we're gonna try to explain. Okay, what I'm gonna do first is try to embody the feeling that I'm talking about. I'm gonna perform it for you. And this is easy for me to do because my father and grandfather and extended family feels this feeling, so I can perform it readily. And then we're going to give it a name and make some observations about it and try to contextualize. Okay, here we go. Are you ready for my performance?
Good. So,
this guy's my inspiration. Okay. Man, is the world upside down? What? Like all these movements for identity rights, equality for this and that, it's like too far. The pendulum has swung, the tables have turned. People who used to say they were oppressed are now the ones who are oppressing us, right? Those woke folks got to tiptoe around political correctness, living in fear of woke police. You know who really has a heart these days? Do you know? Straight white men. But guilty when they walk in the room. Can't even ask a question, can't be themselves, open their mouth. Just trying to be a man makes you toxic. Well, guess what? Now we got a bunch of soft, hurt, confused young men. And that's bad for everybody. Society itself is at risk. I'm sorry to be the bearer of bad news, but it took real men to make civilization. And now somehow they're the bad guy under attack. Screw this. Enough is enough. I'm trying to pick that up for a reason. You can't see it. You see it on Zoom? Enough is enough. Okay. All right. Like I said, this is not meant to be a parody or disrespectful. My family harbors this feeling. And while it tends to be more felt, more taken up by men who would identify as straight, white, cis, Western, we could even say in some cases Christian, right? Many other things. It can be taken up by anybody. It can be felt by anybody, and women too. We can get into that conversation later. What I'd like to do is give this resentment a name. The name I'm going to give it is the grieved manhood, AKA usually straight white manly grievance. I'm going to use this as a kind of like shorthand for the feeling that I just tried to embody. And I want to make some observations about it because ultimately we're getting to the question of how you see this around you. Or do you see this around you? All right, the brief manhood, some key observations we might make. Let's start with my opening point, which I cannot underscore enough, and it's going to be crucial for the rest of today, which is aggrieved manhood of the kind I just performed is about feeling first. It rides on all kinds of content, from anti-trans to homophobia, to white supremacy, to parental rights. It rides on all kinds of content, but it is feeling first. It's about that gnawing sensation. Second thing we can observe is that it is available, if you think about it as like a brewery or a coffee house, it comes in many rooms and different ABV, many strengths. I've got students who kind of quietly whisper it in my gender class. I've got a father who develops it. but we know lots of folks who sort of harbor it and aren't sure, just have questions, right? It comes in many bruises and strengths, many intentions. Another important thing we could note is that it has a history. It has a history that you are seeing unfold before you right now, and on my opening slide as well, that begins in the late 60s and 70s with the anti-feminist, kind of misogynist men's movements that felt displaced by civil rights and feminist movements and reproductive rights and all these sorts of things, and began, that's me and my brother, just thought I'd like acknowledge my stake in it. But in any case, these sort of developments that are featured up here are part of the history of this, but it has exploded, as we might acknowledge, in the last 10 years. And that's a real question for many people. Like, if this is the feeling that's been simmering for literally 50 years, why only in the last 10 years has it just blown up? That is the question we're going to be investigating. When I say it's on rise around the world, earlier I said it's a global movement against DEI-related things. I'm talking about places as disparate as, of course, the US and UK, Australia, you can see some commonalities there, but South Korea, Hungary, Brazil, all over the places the culture wars looking the same. And there's a reason, and this is what we're going to explore. Not only is it on the rise around the world, it's all around us all the time. Like, as you will see in a minute, we are saturated with this. It is in restaurants and pubs and workplaces, right? It's just sort of become part of the sea that we swim in, this particular feeling. And I want to make a claim that it is, in fact, the through line, the common thread, not just to the culture war that we talked about. Think about all those issues, roll through those issues we addressed. The idea that straight white men have lost their place, have been decentered, this kind of seething sense of a rightful virility wrongly denied. This is how I would define aggrieved manhood, that straight white guys are under attack, and this is the new brunt of liberation. That is the through line, not only to these culture wars, but to many events that have confounded us. And I'm going to link together here some things in the next two workshops that might seem like a stretch, they are not a stretch. Everything from election denial to insurrections, plural, to environmental like behaviors, like anti, you know, green behaviors, to mass shootings. We're talking about like the things that are besetting us. The through line is aggrieved manhood, or such is the case, if I'm gonna think. Now you may wonder as I talk about this, why am I calling it manhood or masculinity, aggrieved masculinity, when I have just admitted, and it is crucial to admit, that like race, religion, sexuality, this is an intersectional thing, right? We aren't just talking about any masculinity. We're certainly not talking about all masculinities. Why the gender in name, what I'm calling it? And I'm going to give you a short answer now and a longer answer as we unfold. Because gender, and specifically the gender binary, is how it spreads. Like tech meets the gender binary, is how this feeling has spread around the world and caught fire in the last decade. Okay, right now, we talk about this feeling with a lot of different labels. We say things like the far right or right-wing populism, and I'm going to suggest that these are misleading. That in fact, what has happened is that aggrieved manhood has gone viral, and it prefers to go by names that are more legitimate, right? It prefers to go by names like populism, because that's everybody's, that's the ordinary people's view. Or it likes to go by, even like right-wing politics, because it's a political position. It's masquerading as a legitimate political position. I'm asking us to drop the assumed names and to stop listening for a moment. This is the pause here. Stop listening to the bluster, to what it says, to all the content. Oh my gosh, anti-trans, let's get on that. It's CRT, let's get on that. Stop listening to the content and start asking the question that I've been foregrounding here for the last 10 minutes. How does it spread? not what are they saying, why are they saying it, how does this feeling become infectious? Okay. How many of you, I'm guessing more than most audiences I talk to, are familiar with the term manosphere? Yeah, no, okay, a couple. Okay, great, that's great. So,
not be shy.
What's that?
No, innocence.
Your innocence. Yeah, Catherine says your innocence will be shattered. It's not, certainly not innocence. Okay. So, typically, when people talk about this feeling that I've just described, it means manhood, and they ask the question, why is it happening? Most political scientists, other people give the explanation, the Great Recession. Right? We had this like austerity around the world, and then like there were migration changes, demographic shifts, and this just created a bunch of pissed off people. That's what happened. But scholars of communication, media, digital culture specifically, have been trying to give a different answer to that question for a long time. And what they say is, do you want to know why it has spiked? Then you need to ask how, because the answer is through concrete changes in the kind of media and communication landscape that coincided with the explosion of this feeling. And what they do is point to a decade of, some of you references, we were talking about the culture wars, a decade of online culture war. And we're talking about here the late 2000s to before Trump, like 2015. This is the decade in which grieved manhood took off, found globally. And if you look at those online culture wars, they were not about class at all. They weren't about economic inequality. They weren't about the Great Recession. They were about gender, race, sexuality, anti-feminism, anti-Semitism, these kinds of things, but not about class. And during this period of time, this 10 years, that online kind of raging culture war galvanized something that is known as the manosphere. And forgive this expression, but the manosphere gave what we might consider a global shot of Viagra to the far right. And we need to understand the role of tech in this. Okay, remember that I said this is gonna be a more complex account, that I'm not making the case that the internet did it by any means, but rather what I'm suggesting is that in that 10-year period, a new circuitry of sensation was born. Just kind of hear this new circuitry of sensation, a network that is like the technical network, body, human body, relation, that has actually heightened our physical susceptibility to the transmission of volatile feeling. So say that one more time. We're talking not here about like the internet or particular people, but their relationship, the network body relation, that has kind of changed the circuitry of feeling and made us more susceptible to the physical transmission of bodily feelings, especially those that are more explosive. Okay. A couple things we could say about this. Let's first just say what the manosphere is. So the manosphere is a term that in around 2010, it's used by some in the manosphere, but it started with many kind of feminist digital culture scholars who were trying to point out that we've reached a kind of critical tipping point where the online phase of anti-feminist movements, like, what we now think of as incels. Can we give names to these pickup artists? Men going their own way, MGTOW. There's like whole volumes that introduce you to all these different communities. It's websites, blogs, lots of stuff that's monetized, videos, etc. But it's basically the online phase. And sometime around Gamergate, which we probably, most of us remember, do we? 2014, okay. Oh, I'll give a brief history to this, but Gamergate was basically the moment when the manosphere started getting like popping into public attention. This was when a woman, a female game designer, was like trolled, doxxed, you know, like all this sort of shit posting to such a violent extent that it ended up the entire gaming industry. It was about gender in the gaming industry, but it was the first place that the manosphere appeared on the public register as an actual like actor in its own right. But it went from a kind of individualized to people organized, like a bunch of trolls kind of, you know, getting their rocks off on it, to a thing that was beginning to act as a thing. And the term manosphere is trying to capture that, the way that this feeling spread to a point where it began acting as a thing. And one of the digital, I'm just going to mention one digital scholar that has seen it and used in Denmark, who has done this extensive studies of like feeling in relation to Gamergate. And one of the things she tries to challenge is people often think of Gamergate as like, okay, you've got all these young guys who are used to gaming, and then they got radicalized, ideologically radicalized through this process. And they started hooking into this idea that, yes, great white men are oppressed and women are the devil and queer folks are the devil and this sort of thing. But what she shows is it's not ideological radicalization. It wasn't like the content they were gripping onto. It was the repetitive physical sensation of one thrill after another, operating somewhat like an addiction, like let's escalate it, could the high be better this time, right? And she documents this in such a powerful way. So endless repetition in point-to-point encounters keeps this feeling on the move in every sense. It draws clicks, it draws out viewing time, it travels and adapts from place to place, culture to culture, replicates, it becomes a physical reflex, shitposting, trolling, doxing, swatting, etc. Am I making sense? It's physical. It's not ideological. Okay. So Gamergate just gives us an example of how this works. I want to use a pinball. Anybody play pinball? Yeah? Okay. You at least know how it works. And you know that there is a moment. You think of it as like a player and a machine, you know? So, okay, there's a clear agent and an object. But there's a moment where the ball of the player. Like it doesn't really matter who's like what you do. You can do anything you want to the box, but the ball or whatever you call it is just pinging around the field. And it's like its own kinetic motion, one thing after the next. And it's like lighting up and generating value like on its own. And this is the key, it's generating value. Like points are racking up. This is how the manosphere operates, by pinging the feeling from one place to the next. Physical repetition, granular accounts of like, ooh, a manly grievance in my neighborhood, and my sharing, escalating, et cetera. Okay. The argument that I am making here is that the manosphere has become a super spreader. Sorry for the COVID terminology. We should move over it, right? But it is like the incubator, the super spreader of aggrieved manhood. It is what transmits, I'm sorry for all this tongue twister, translates, that is culturally translates, transmutes, changes what it, so defund DEI here in the States will be called, let's end gender studies in Hungary, right? Like as it goes by different names, takes different shape, but it is moving transnationally. It is not a US problem. It is not in any way localized. And the manosphere is a key part of that. I think it is critical to acknowledge that, the manosphere is far from online. It's like at this point, it has obliterated the online offline distinction. That makes no sense anymore. As we were talking about water loops, right? It's increasingly present all around us. And earlier I said this was a story of feeling meets network. And I want to elongate that and try to kind of summarize what I've said. Feeling meets network. Another way to put that is this: boy meets boy online, and another, sharing, scheming, sparring, rehearsing, amassing, intensifying, grievance upon grievance, an entire global network charged by the repetitive thrill of escalating rage, trading in volatility, relishing it, monetizing it, pushing it to the edge and over until the craving for that high saturates their most intimate spaces. The grievances are starting to pile up all around them, finding root in the everyday of our local lives. The thirst for revenge grows, first as whispers in the office, then jokes on the shop floor. It simmers in schools. It bursts forth from pubs and pulpits alike. It struts onto the political stage as it did in 2016 and slips into the voting booth, exploding all the while in one mass shooting after another. All of us with no choice, streaming his pain. It's not exactly clever, but a grief management is the number one show in the world right now, because you're watching it constantly. No subscription required, but the costs are increasingly high. Now, I want to get technical about one last detail with the manosphere. I mentioned earlier why gender, right? And I said that we need to lead with gender in calling this feeling by its name. A grieved man can need to lead with gender because that is how it spreads. And the way that this feeling exploded on the network is by traveling on a binary code, the easiest way to travel, the gender binary. So you can take all the variations in race and religion dynamics in different places, all the different orientations to what we call LGBTQ, queer communities. There's so many different national, regional stances on these things, but the gender binary is a recognizable from which it can flow and find root. If you don't believe me, I'd like to, I understand why you wouldn't. I just researched it for a long time, but I think that this is a credible source. This will be the only time I will call a neo-Nazi founder of a Daily Stormer. If you're familiar with Daily Stormer, a very well-known neo-Nazi website, well-known depending on the kind of research you do, who offers this. There are literal style guides on the manosphere for producing, spreading the feeling. So how do you get young boys hooked? What's called like slow red pill? How do you pull them in? And this is his advice given in the style guide and at a conference. Quote, what resonates the most in my experience is issues surrounding the displacement and disenfranchisement of the white male, which has taken place as a result of feminism. That is the gateway to all of this. Do not start with the race issue. So anti-feminism, anti-homosexuality, and preservation of male identity, which is on the first slide, and the man's role in society, that should always be the core focus of the brand. He literally said brand, because branding is what this is about, as we will get into a little bit later. Okay, so this is my claim, is that the gender binding, that like two-way code, is what makes it so easy for this to blossom, mushroom over a network, to flow across the truth. Okay, so let's do two things. I see the time. I wanna first just see like, where are you with this? What questions do you have? What observations do you have? I told you that today was so great, but there is like this whole sort of paradigm for rethinking how to respond to this. What does DEI work look like in the midst of a feeling that has run wild? And that's where we're going to be headed. But what questions, thoughts, observations, feelings have you so far? How much of this is new?
I had two thoughts.
Okay.
One is that quote that you just read reminds me of a quote from, I believe it was a KKK member who was. It was his job to try to bring in new members.
Yeah.
Big anti-Semitism. But he said that his family likes to watch Tucker Carlson every night. I mean, not anymore. But they like to watch it every night, twice a night. They first watch it for enjoyment, and then they watch it and take notes because he's so good at enslaving men. So that was one thing that I heard. But then the question I have is, and I hope we get to it at some point, how do we protect our young?
Yes.
I have three sons.
Yes.
How do we protect them from this? So
this is the subject of 2 and 3. Yes. And can I just say, I don't want to talk too much to the, it's just a powerful point on two levels, but the Tucker Carlson thing specifically. One of the things that I do in the book is just trace how many of the primetime mainstream issues that have been raised, like great replacement theory, if you're familiar with that, the idea that like we're trying to replace white folks by like having lots of babies, brown people having lots of babies, right? And so they call it, he was the first person to like talk about this on a show, straight out of the manosphere. Like so much of this content is directly traceable to these communities. And increasingly they have a main line to like, right, you know, GOP culture wars are basically like streaming them out of the manosphere, the content. And the thing is, people will hear great replacement theory and think, well, that's about race. And that's what we do. And it is, of course it's about race, but it is also about reproductive politics. And there is also an element of great replacement theory that is about, which Tucker Carlson's constantly talking about, feminists are ruining, you know, the race because they won't have babies. And so there's also this element. And then you get in like, what do we say? Abortion being one of these reproductive rights? Okay, absolutely, because great replacement theory is about race and reproduction, which requires white women to not be feminist and have like bodily autonomy, right? So this new move to refer to, you know, politics around abortion as forced birth advocates actually makes sense. Right? I mean, it actually does make sense because it's tied together. So, of course they like him because he is literally drawing his content of what enrages off of the manosphere. And I've shown this with Josh Hawley. Anybody know who Senator Josh Hawley is? His speeches written by the manosphere. He just put out a book about masculinity. Like, it is so something. It is so something. Other comments? Other just reflections?
Right. The whole it travels across the binary. It's just like a worm in my brain now. I can't stop thinking about it.
Really?
Yeah. It's interesting to think about because it forces you to have such black and white thinking about things.
Yeah.
There's no, you can't let yourself have room for nuance about gender.
Yeah.
When you think about it that way. And that's why it's so destructive. And I see what you mean. It's at the heart of so many things.
Yes.
Because the way that we think in conventional society is you are this or you are that. You don't even really have that as much with race or a lot of LGBT stuff because it's like, well, people can be mixed race or people can be bisexual.
It's harder for those resentments to travel across cultural, across time and place and cultural lines. But there's no, to me, clearer example that this is at the heart of it. You know, the whole anti-CRT, anti-critical race theory scare. As that was getting going, there was a guy by the name of Russell Vought who came out of the Trump administration, who started this organization to basically create like materials for school boards, for parents, women usually, to go to school boards and scream and yell about parental rights. And so it's like a template that you should use in your schools about critical race theory. And at the very end of the template, it says, while you're at it, it's critical to say we believe in biological sex only, girl or boy, right? It's like this whole like agenda about race, but it's very important to get in there that the gender binary is real, and that is what we're gonna, right? And this is so despite all the different sort of ways that gender is showing up in these culture wars globally, the one constant is reinstating a natural gender by men, women. And I'm telling you, it's because that is how it travels. That is how all of these resentments can be packaged and trapped. So I can't underscore that enough. I'm glad it's in the brain. Let it be. Yeah.
Just a question. You're talking about the manifesto and the instructions about the messaging.
Yeah.
Who's doing that today?
Okay. So that is today.
One person leading this.
No, and this is why I started with that earlier exercise about like 1,000 hands pulling 1,000 levers for their own selfish intentions. Like some of them just want like my ratings and monetize my videos, like Andrew Tate, right? Andrew Tate is, if you're not familiar with him, you know, we can talk about that. But that's a great example of somebody who's like, does he care about the larger manosphere? Is he out there for particular Christian nationalism? Hell no. But he's found his own stake and he's pulling that lever, right? Andrew Anglin is one of those figures. But what you can find is, like, it's dispersed all over. So they, these style guides flow. So Andrew Anglin has one, MGTOW have their own, they compete. They like actually kind of shitpost one another about like your sucks. Like they're, that's part of drawing up the energy actually is like escalating it over who has the best plan to pull in young boys. And then like comparing notes on how it's, so it's just very dispersed, but it's part of the conversation. Part of that escalation. Yeah.
I think this is really validating because even when you started kind of going to the content, I was like, oh, the incel thing, the shooting in Santa Barbara, you know, all this stuff. Like,
yes,
I would easily come up and then you're like, oh, yeah, it's all connected. And so it's nice to have like a name to it now. And I think one thing I'm wondering as a researcher is how do you keep yourself safe given that you have a, what I'm guessing based on your even Google Scholar publishing a book with your name on it? Like,
yes.
How do you manage your own risk and safety as you engage with both this content to protect your own psychological safety, but also are you, do you become a target of these people because you're researching it?
I partly, it's interesting. I feel like partly because I am a professor of communication and organizations, like I'm not on gender studies, like target websites.
Mm-hmm.
And so, and the book is pretty new, but I am braced for that and I did delete me and you know it's worth it to do the project and my own psychological safety is another question. You could probably, Catherine, if she was, could probably attest to how depressed I got writing this book and scared, right?
Yes.
Like,
oh my god, didn't you have, I mean it was just texting me, but
yeah,
but didn't you have your global presence clear?
Oh yeah, I mean as much as you can, right?
Yeah,
but yeah, I mean again, it's like there are several folks who, on whose work I depended, who been like into these communities, and also had like the technical capability to explore these arguments and document them, and they really suffered. So I would also point, you know, to that precedent. Be grateful for their work. Any other just immediate reactions? Anybody want to argue against it? I'd love to hear that.
No, thank you. But I did want to say, and maybe I'm just like trying to end on like a hopeful note, but it seems that like this idea of the binary, which is like so compelling about this, also like opens up, like so many people don't fit within the binary.
Yeah.
And like that opens up so much space for like coalition building among them. And so I'm hoping that we can talk about that.
Yes, I'm dancing about it. So we may as well talk about it, but absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And so I do think it is important for us to be sobered. I do. And I'm not trying to, not you particularly, and probably not those of us who are on the receiving end of this, right? But like, we have to start calling it by its name, not populism, not like the far right. Increasingly, like in journalistic practice, you can see these protests with all men, or would be like two women, and they'll say, okay, there's women there, so it's not about gender. It's amazing how gender gets dropped out of the register. Mm-hmm. And of course it is about these other things, race, you know, sexuality, all those things too, but it's that part, that gender binary, that we need to be like, what work does it do, and what other work could we get it to do to organize a resistance? So just so you know where this is headed, the next time we'll be talking about like, what does it mean to treat this not as toxic masculinity, a term we've had around for a long time, but to treat it as viral masculinity. Because when you have a viral, like pandemic frame, you would orient to it very differently and think about the resistance organizing, even DEI trainings, really differently. It wouldn't be like fighting over the content, you'd be getting at the feeling. Right. And so that's also where your question about like young boys, the people who are exposed online, 6-year-olds shooting in a, you know, like the radicalization happens early. But if we understand it as a emotional, as a feeling basis, a physical radicalization, and not just about content, there are other modes of response that are possible. So I wanted to, in the last 5 minutes, maybe close with just a prompt for reflection, promising you that, like I said at the beginning, there is a narrative arc here, and it will. So this is my question to you, and this is just for, you know, individual reflection, writing, typing, whatever you're doing. How does what I've called here aggrieved manhood, that feeling for the manosphere, you know, how does that show up in the context of your life? So one might be like, I have a son and I worry about it, right? That's a good example. But it could also be things like, you know, I had a colleague at the publisher who published the book, who said, after reading this book, I started thinking about all the ways that I'm constantly a sweet, like softening, you know, for the men in my life. Like, no, it's not really about that. And like, this is what I'm speaking into. I'm worried about them being angry or resenting this. And I'm already addressing and softening myself in this way. So that's what I mean. Like, what are the ways that it shows up? It could be so many different ways. So just take a moment as we close to brainstorm those. And we will debrief it next time. Okay? Yeah. That's great.
So why aren't the women doing something similar?
Yeah.
Kind of. There's been some there.
There's
I have kind of an interesting like anecdote of that is. So there's like those pickup artists and
yes.
like the male dating coaches. I've seen like the female dating coaches that are like reactive to the men wanting to get the best possible product by making the most money and getting the hottest woman. And then women reactively dating in a way that's like, I need a high value man. I need a this, this, and this. I need a man who's going to be a provider. Like I've seen an uptick in that from a female perspective. And that kind of concerns me because my hope is that like women can collectively take the responsibility to break down this like individualist capitalist approach to dating. And I'm using the lens of dating, of course,
in
that right now.
Yeah.
Thinking about that. But it's just interesting to see that because it's like it's sad to think that there are a lot of women who've just kind of given up the idea of like a genuine connection with a man. And now they see them as a target in the same way that men.
It's just like there's a parallel here to when, I don't know, like this, okay, I'm dating myself, but that's cool. Back in the day when everybody was talking about assertiveness training, like women need to be more like men and lead more like men. And it's like this, it's like, that's one way to go with this is to say, so why don't women kind of take up this mantle of like also flex and puff, you know? And I guess the hope would be because, yeah, that really actually reinstates that gender binary. That does not tackle it, right? So it's just hopping to another side. And then also further, usually when you do that, you're also further like denigrating other women, you know? So, yeah.
Well, it's so hard too, because it's like, you don't want to feed into that, but then at the same time, the like burden of care is disproportionately on
yes.
them to like take
yes,
care of
it. That's what I was feeling when you said women should stand up and do this. It's like, but it can't just be all women. Like a huge part of the point of this project is everyone has a stake in interrupting the circuits of aggrieved manhood. And that includes men. This is not an anti-man, anti-individual. It's like men are not benefiting from this either. It is destroying this, what we'll talk about next time, all of us. So everybody has a stake, hopefully. It doesn't just have to be, you know, women. But anyway, I interrupted you, so say more.
Oh, that was all.
Oh, okay.
There are only women in here. So have you done the same thing with a bunch of men?
Yes.
And what do they say about this?
Yes. I mean, we can talk about this. I mean, I actually think that the next kind of segment on viral masculinity is probably the most compelling for them because they can see how what is being circulated actually has hurt their lives and their children, and there is no payoff really for anyone. And especially when you attach it to like the climate and like planetary health. And if we keep doubling down on aggrieved manhood, like we're all gonna go. You know, like, we can't do it. So I think there's ways that they can find their stake. I mean, to your point, that's something I really try to stress, is like, this should be as concerning for men, if not more, because it is like hurting their lives. And yeah.
And I think what I would add to that, but you clean it up with speaking, but I think that this is actually a move away from putting blame on individual actors in general,
yeah,
individual men in particular, right? So it may seem kind of like before you get the whole picture, like it's man hating or something like that, but it's actually moving towards making more about this feeling that passes through the world that nobody is really in control of, and it's not about putting blame on individual men.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's right. I'm not going to clean that up.
That's good.
But there's like this whole, the area of scholarship that I'm in is about like this sort of thing, like the social, the physical flow of emotions, right? So, like, yeah. I think those folks have some really interesting intervention possibilities.
And that we hear about next.
Yeah.
What was your book called again?
I have it with me. It's called Viral Masculinity, I'll go back to the first, okay? And the populace has been wronged and dangerous. Here it is. So why? Can't I just go with it? There it is. Viral Masculinity and the populace. Okay. So, okay. Are we online? Are they inside the ice?
Nope, we're still.
Okay. Do they?
Yeah.
Okay, so this last reflection thing about how it shows up in your life, please just kind of chew on that for a little bit. And that's what we will start with as we get into the next session, because we want to start identifying some contexts for intervention, places where you think it's most pressing. And so that kind of comes from your response to this question. So thank you so much. And thank you for your patience also to the online Zoom folks as we figured out our technical issues. We appreciate you. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you.